I'm Liyana Hassanel, and Nightline begins now. News making the headlines. Government to raise public health care expenditure to 5% of GDP. And government to look at alternative punishment to caning. Good morning. The government will raise public health expenditure to 5% of the country's gross domestic product, GDP. Health Minister Khairi Jamaluddin said Prime Minister Datuk Seri Ismail Sabri Yaakob had given his commitment to increase the allocation to ensure a better healthcare system in the country for future generations.
Saya maklumkan kepada PM, saya kata kita punya perbelanjaan public health, kesihatan awam 2.58% KDNK. Untuk upper middle income country sepatutnya antara 4% hingga 5%. Dan Alhamdulillah semalam pada perasmian Hospital Bera, Yang Amat Berhormat telah umumkan bahawa beliau sendiri sokong supaya perbelanjaan kesihatan kita akan ditingkatkan secara gradual sehingga sampai ke sasaran 5% KDNK.
The Health Minister said this in his speech during the Keluarga Malaysia Symposium, Achievements and Aspirations at the Putrajaya International Convention Centre on Sunday. He added that the move was needed so that the Health Ministry can carry out its long-term plans to provide more sustainable, affordable and accessible world-class healthcare system for the people. This was also part of the healthcare reforms in the Health White Paper, which is expected to be tabled in Parliament in November. During the symposium, Khairi also presented the achievements of the Health Ministry since he was appointed as its minister nearly a year ago on August 26th. He highlighted that 92% of the 57,355 backlogged non-COVID-19 treatment cases recorded at government hospitals across the country up to September 2021 have been resolved to date. He also said that 4,053 medical, dental and pharmaceutical officers have been offered permanent posts by the Public Service Department up to last week, the biggest number since 2016. Caning as a punishment in Malaysia should be reviewed holistically, as it can be considered inhumane and outdated. Minister in the Prime Minister's Department for Parliament and Law, Datuk Seri Wan Junaidi Tuanku Jaafar, said caning was introduced as a punishment during the colonial era, but many countries no longer implement it.
Sebatan is so brutal, is so inhuman, is so... Saya tak tahulah. I lost for word. Yeah? Sebatan ni. Bila orang sebut sebat ni sampai 15 kali, Masya Allah, yang 3 kali pun dah pengsan. Orang dah setengah mati kata sebat sampai 15 kali tu.
Speaking to reporters on the sidelines of the Keluarga Malaysia Symposium at Putrajaya International Convention Centre on Sunday, Datuk Seri Wan Junaidi said a review of caning should be conducted. He said a technical committee will be set up to study the matter, which will gather input from all stakeholders. Currently, caning is imposed only on adult male convicts aged 50 and below. Datuk Seri Wan Junaidi also did not rule out the possibility of removing caning as a punishment altogether, based on the feedback from various stakeholders and the technical committee to be formed. Prime Minister Datuk Seri Ismail Sabri Yaakob said he will announce good news for civil servants on August 30th. In his speech at the launching of the Keluarga Malaysia Symposium at the Putrajaya International Convention Centre, PICC, on Sunday morning, Datuk Seri Ismail Sabri hinted that the announcement is to recognise the contribution civil servants have made to the country.
InsyaAllah, insyaAllah, kita akan mengumumkan sesuatu yang menceriakan bagi mengubat duka lara kepada para penjawat awam pada Majlis Amanat Perdana Perkhidmatan Awam yang dijadualkan pada 30 hari bulan Ogos nanti. Tunggulah. Saya pun tengah fikir ni.
Dato' Sri Ismail Sabri added that the police, the Malaysian Armed Forces, the Fire and Rescue Department, the Welfare Department, the Health Department and those in other agencies continue to show commitment towards carrying out their responsibilities even during times when the country was facing a challenging period. He said the Keluarga Malaysia Administration recognizes the sacrifices made by civil servants under the leadership of Chief Secretary to the Government, Tan Sri Muhammad Zuki Ali. He added that the services and sacrifices of these unsung heroes will be etched in the country's history, especially during times when disaster hit the country, such as during the COVID-19 pandemic and the unexpected major floods. Meanwhile, as he leads the Keluarga Malaysia government into its second year, Dato' Sri Ismail Sabri Yaakob has strengthened his resolve to enhance the government administration and national economy for the benefit of the people. In his speech at the event, the Prime Minister stressed that there were many more matters on the agenda of his government that could be implemented to help Keluarga Malaysia.
Masih banyak agenda yang boleh kita laksanakan. Masih ramai golongan yang perlu kita bantu, baik golongan miskin, golongan wanita, golongan orang kurang upaya dan sebagainya. Saya berharap agar kita akan terus dapat menguatkan tekad dan semangat untuk sama-sama berusaha memantapkan lagi pentadbiran kerajaan dan memulihkan ekonomi negara untuk manfaat seluruh keluarga Malaysia.
Dato' Sri Ismail Sabri said the Yang di-Pertuan Agong Al-Sultan Abdullah Riayatuddin Al-Mustafa Billah Shah and the Malay rulers were always concerned about the country's well-being and the people's welfare. And on the advice of His Majesty, the government took the initiative to set aside differences with the opposition by signing a bipartisan cooperation agreement. He said various initiatives of the Keluarga Malaysia government received wide support from all quarters because consultation sessions were held before their introduction. Dato' Sri Ismail Sabri also expressed his appreciation to the King and Malay rulers for their advice and support to the Keluarga Malaysia government throughout the past 1 year. He also thanked all members of the Cabinet and members of Parliament from both the government and opposition benches for supporting the government's initiatives. Children born overseas to Malaysian women married to foreign spouses may not get automatic citizenship at birth, but they can still apply to be Malaysians. Attorney General Tan Sri Idris Harun, however, acknowledged that the process may take a longer time, adding that matters involving the issue are being looked into by the Home Ministry.
So, perkara ini kita sedang kaji sekarang lah. Kita mahu ada kita akan apa kata benarkan kalau anak tu lahirkan mak dia pun citizen, bapa tak citizen, boleh jadi apa kata rakyat Malaysia by operation of law.
He said this at the Keluarga Malaysia Symposium, Achievements and Aspirations, in Putrajaya on Sunday. When asked by reporters to comment further on the issue, Tan Sri Idris said another option to resolve the citizenship issue involving children born abroad to Malaysian mothers with foreign spouses is to amend the second schedule of the federal constitution. He, however, said this amendment has to be made by the government. The Court of Appeal, in reversing a High Court ruling recently, ruled that children born to Malaysian women married to foreign spouses were not entitled to, by operation of law, be Malaysian citizens. Two of the three judges who sat in the Court of Appeal had ruled that the word father in the Second Schedule, Part 2 of the Constitution, meant the biological father and cannot be extended to include the mother or parents. The budget 2023, which will be tabled on October 28th, will focus on strengthening the digital economy, especially in rural areas. Deputy Finance Minister Wan, Datuk Muhammad Shahar Abdullah, said this was to ensure that rural communities were not left out of the technology in developing their economic resources.
Kalau kita melihat saiz pasaran e-dagang ini berkembang begitu besar pada tahun 2025, sebanyak 1.65 trilion ringgit. Jadi kita yakin prospek pada tahun hadapan ekonomi digital akan lebih besar. Kita kena buat persediaan bukan sahaja di bandar-bandar besar tetapi ekonomi digital juga harus diperkasakan di luar bandar selaras dan seiring dengan perkembangan teknologi.
He said this after attending the Merdeka at Community Keluarga Malaysia in Kota Baru, Kelantan on Sunday. He said visits had been conducted nationwide to see the public's willingness to apply digital technology in their business, especially at the village level. Datuk Muhammad Shahar said budget 2023 would also look into implementing consumer subsidies as well as measures to restore the country's economy. In other news, the Human Resources Ministry has not received any application to implement 4.5 days of work in Johor. Its Deputy Minister, Datuk Awang Hashim, said the ministry has not received any official agreement on the matter and has not held any engagement session to discuss the reduction of working hours in the state.
Sebelum kita announce, sebelum kita bawa apa-apa round undang-undang, sesuatu round undang ke Dewan Rakyat, ataupun Dewan Negara, kita ada libat urus. Jadi kita bila dah dapat libat urus, bincang dan persetujuan dengan semua pihak, oh kita bawa.
However, Datuk Awang Hashim said he will leave it up to the Johor State Government to make a decision on the matter. He said this when asked to comment on recent reports that Johor might announce 4.5 days of work each week, followed by a 2.5 day weekend. He said this to reporters after taking part in an engagement session for Sekolah Kusejahtera at the Kedah State Education Department on Sunday. Cities globally are taking initiatives and working on a sustainable urbanization approach that centers on reducing the carbon footprint or greenhouse gas GHG emissions. However, this move provides a number of competitive challenges to urban dwellers in getting good public infrastructure, mass housing, energy, health and transportation, among many others. Alif Yunus reports.
Advisory Council member of Malaysian Institute of Planners, Noliza Hashim, said deterioration of livability challenges related to waste management, scarce resources, air pollution and traffic congestion that cause human health concerns, as well as aging public infrastructure, are some of the problems generated by rapid urbanization.
Like Kuala Lumpur, for example, we know for Kuala Lumpur, you know, it is going through a phase of rapid urbanization. Population increase in the last 20-30 years have been very drastic, you know. But also when you talk about urbanization, you talk about not only people, but you talk about how centers are becoming economic centers. So people come to get jobs, you know. And therefore, you do need to manage urbanization to make sure that the whole process of urbanization becomes very sustainable. Now, when we talk about city, generally you do have a domain. That means to say you have a boundary. And in that city, you have natural resources, you have rivers, sometimes you have hills, you have natural areas that needs to be protected, you know, because the ecosystem of the city becomes very important. And then on top of that, you have people who are living in the areas, and that is very dynamic, you know. The people who are living there, not only they grow, but they change their profile, you know.
She also pointed out that people-centered and the eco-friendly urban environment is necessary to lead a comfortable urban life in cities in Malaysia. According to Centre for Environment, Technology and Development Malaysia Chairman Gumit Singh, outreach and educational programs on low-carbon lifestyles are still lacking among communities, students and youth. As such, it is quite difficult to empower the public to participate.
I think the basic question to start with, first them, to get them to understand what is low-carbon thing, because people here generally have not really very much concerned about climate change, and in low-carbon is even more. And low-carbon, the thing is something else people do. But I think basically they need to use the NGOs, perhaps mobilize more the NGOs and the residents association to explain to them what is low-carbon actually involves. Does it just involve how can you take the carbon out of the thing? Basically, it's not that. You do activities that will reduce the carbon footprint, your carbon footprint, and this can be in a whole range of ways.
Gurmit also said that it is crucial for the government to focus on managing proper urbanization plans before formulating proper measures and actions that will catapult the pathway to low carbon cities. Rapid developments of cities are unavoidable as it is the main driving force for economic growth and achieving the status of a high-income nation. Therefore, the future of cities in developing countries, including Malaysia, and their impact on climate change depend very much on decisions made now in preparation for this growth. Alif Yunus, TV3.
Coming up next, a car bomb kills the daughter of a hardline Kremlin ideologue just outside Moscow. Stay with us.
Penjualan rokok seludup berleluasa di pasaran.
Somali forces have ended a siege at a hotel in Somalia's capital, Mogadishu. Police and the military said on Sunday, adding that they had rescued 106 hostages, including women and children. Health Minister Ali Adan on Sunday confirmed the deaths of 21 people as Somalia's elite armed forces battled the Al-Shabaab group for 30 hours after they blasted and shot their way into the Hyatt Hotel on Friday evening. Another 117 were wounded in the attack. Police believe the death toll is likely to rise as a search operation is underway to recover bodies from the debris. The French news agency Agence France-Presse earlier reported that all the gunmen had been killed, citing a security commander. On Sunday morning, the area surrounding the hotel was quiet and the roads were blocked by a heavy security presence as emergency workers and bomb disposal experts sought to clear the premises of any explosives and remove rubble. Russia has deployed hypersonic Kinzhal or Dagger missiles three times over the course of what Moscow calls a special military operation in Ukraine. Defense Minister Sergei Shoigu on Sunday said the missiles had proved effective in hitting high-value targets on all three occasions, adding that they could hit almost any point in the world and evade a U.S.-built missile shield. The Kinzhal, which is Dagger in Russian, is a nuclear-capable hypersonic ballistic missile, one of six new next-generation weapons unveiled by Vladimir Putin in March 2018. Reports suggest the weapon is designed to be launched from MiG-31 fighter jets at altitudes of about 18 kilometers and can travel at least five times the speed of sound. Russia first used the Kinzhal system in Ukraine, striking a large weapons depot in Ukraine's western Ivano-Frankivsk region. Russia's defense ministry said three MiG-31E warplanes equipped with Kinzhal missiles had been relocated to the Kaliningrad region this week. The daughter of Alexander Dugin, a hardline Russian ideologue close to President Vladimir Putin, has been killed in a car bombing on Moscow's outskirts. Dugin was a vocal supporter of Kremlin's offensive in Ukraine. and was the likely target of the blast as his daughter borrowed his car at the last minute. Daria Dugina died on the scene when a bomb placed in her Toyota Land Cruiser went off as she drove on a highway near the village of Bolshyi Vizhyomi, some 40 kilometers outside Moscow. Dugin has long advocated the unification of Russian-speaking territories in a vast new Russian empire and wholeheartedly supported Moscow's operation in Ukraine. A wildfire in the Valencia region left scorched land, burned out homes and blackened trees, sites which greeted returning residents. Authorities have said that firefighting had gone well on Saturday night and more evacuees could return to their towns on Sunday, even as 21 planes and helicopters were still active in the area. Wildfires have recently burned across areas of eastern Spain as strong winds fanned fires raging through parched bushland, burning more than 19,000 hectares in the Valencia region. And according to a study published in the Nature Geoscience Journal, climate change has left parts of the Iberian Peninsula at their driest in 1,200 years. Coming up next, actions from the Super League. Penjualan rokok. Two Super League matches were played Sunday night. Pahang beat Terengganu 2-1, while PJ City beat Selangor 1-0. At the Darul Makmur Stadium in Kuantan, Pahang, after a scoreless first half, Manuel Hidalgo opened the scoring for the hosts in the 47th minute. Habib Harun levelled the score for Terengganu in the 70th minute, before Petrus Chilembi scored the winner in the 87th minute for Terengganu to secure a narrow 2-1 win over Sri Pahang. still on football. Werder Bremen scored three times in the final minutes to come from two goals down and snatch a stunning 3-2 victory at Borussia Dortmund that ended the hosts' winning start to the season. Dortmund, who were lackluster throughout, thought they had done enough to win the game after being 2-0 up until the 89th minute via goals from Julian Brandt in the first half stoppage time and Rafael Guerrero in the 77th minute. That is when Lee Buchanan launched the sensational comeback of visitors in the 89th minute. Niklas Schmid drew them level before Oliver Burke's stunning winner deep in stoppage time, which left Dortmund on 6 points from their first three games. Werder have now become the first Bundesliga team to score three goals in a game from the 89th minute onwards. Up next, cops nabbed human traffickers and undocumented migrants after high-speed car chase. This and more after this short break. Pinang, the body of a man who was believed to have drowned at Pantai Tanjung Asam, Bayan Lepas, on Saturday, was found floating near the beach earlier Sunday morning. The victim, identified as 20-year-old Estana Silan, was discovered by fishermen about 600 metres from the beach area. City Balik Pulau Fire and Rescue Department Chief Muhammad Faris Mansor said the body was handed over to the police after the identification process was carried out by the victim's family, who waited on the beach. Earlier, it was reported that the young man had drowned while swimming with some of his friends at the beach on Saturday. It was believed that the victim went missing after being swept away by strong currents. Two men from a human trafficking syndicate were arrested for transporting 9 illegal immigrants at the Damansara Puchong Highway on Saturday. Petaling Jaya Police Chief ACP Muhammad Fakhruddin Abdul Hamid said the suspects were detained after a nearly 7-kilometre high-speed chase in Petaling Jaya. ACP Muhammad Fakhruddin said that policemen patrolling the highway had spotted the car as it was travelling near the Panchala Toll Plaza. Patrolmen found the vehicle had an expired road tax and ordered it to pull over. A high-speed chase ensued when the driver of the car refused to do so. The 7-kilometre chase ended when the driver was forced to stop after crashing into two cars. The local suspects, aged 31 and 36, jumped out of the car and tried to flee on foot, but were later arrested by police. Upon checking the car, police found 8 men and a woman, all foreigners aged between 22 and 43 years old, crammed inside with their luggage. The suspects were held under Laws of the Security Offences Special Measures Act and are being investigated for human trafficking. Meanwhile, the foreigners who did not possess any travel documents were detained for immigration offences. We'll be right back. 1 year after the return to power of the Taliban in Afghanistan, kites fly in London's sky as a sign of solidarity with the Afghan people. The event was co-organized by humanitarian association Afghan Aid, with more than 100 people participating in Hampstead Heath Park. Let's take a look at the event as we wrap up Nightline this time around. And with that, I'm Lena Hassanel. Thank you for watching and stay safe, Malaysia.